This is John Johnson for KPBX FM, and welcome to Johnson's Improbable History of Pop.
Let me taste your life! Let me fill your stream!
Grand Funk Railroad's roots go directly back to their hometown of Flint, Michigan, a huge auto parts manufacturing center for decades that was the subject of an early Michael Moore documentary. Bass player Mark Farner and drummer Don Brewer were part of Terry Knight and the Pack, a mid-60s garage band with one top 50 national hit, I Who Have Nothing. In 1969, their vocalist Terry Knight gave up the microphone and turned himself into a new-styled, high-powered manager, and eventually renamed the group Grand Funk Railroad, with the addition of bassist Mel Shocker and reassignment of Farner to guitar. What resulted was a hard-rocking trio with solid work ethics that sold tons of albums despite, or maybe because, of critical disfavor. Their first single in the summer of 1969, Time Machine, went top 50, and their debut album that fall hit the top 30. They developed a solid reputation as a crowd-pleasing live attraction in the early days. They also delivered a dependable and reliable brand of no-nonsense Detroit-style hard rock proto-metal, not that far removed from their Michigan peers Ted Nugent, the MC5, Iggy and the Stooges, Bob Seger, and others. They are a band whose music perhaps has sometimes got lost in the hype, pro and con. Well, tonight our guest for this evening, frequent contributor to this program and longtime Grand Funk fan Ben Upham of Spokane, will help fill in a sonic portrait of the group and perhaps, Ben, set the record at least a bit straighter, right?
That's what I'm hoping, John. Hoping to open up some people's ears and turn up some stereos around this town.
When did you first get exposed to this group?
I was in 1970, and at the time I was about 13, and the only music I was listening to was the Beach Boys. Couldn't handle hard rock at all, and I picked up Grand Funk's first live album. It was in early 1970, and first high-energy rock and roll that ever really did it for me.
Well, from the Beach Boys to Grand Funk with no stops in between, that's going a bit over the top, wouldn't you say?
It's even worse than that, John. I actually heard Jimi Hendrix and thought it was awful, so I owe a lot to these guys.
Okay.
They opened the door.
They opened the door, and it's one that you haven't closed yet, I guess.
Absolutely not.
Now, we're going to go back and do a real cross-section of their career. What is it we're going to be getting started with?
We're going to start out with a track off of their third record, which was called Closer to Home. The song is called Sin's a Good Man's Brother. That was from early 1970. And we will follow that up with a track from their an outtake from their 1974 album Shining On, produced by Todd Rundgren. The song is called Destitute and Losin', and it's the B-side of Locomotion, which went to number one.
Fantastic. Now, Ben, you realize, of course, that you have brought that idea to the right program because, you know, like the old Blue Oyster Cult song, Time to Play B-Sides, Burning for You, right? This is a program dedicated to playing B-sides, and you've got a B-side outtake. I don't know what else I could ask.
Well, it's great. I mean, I got turned on to it, you know, as a youth when I was playing pool at a resort, and I saw they had Locomotion. Well, I played the B-side.
Well, of course.
I played way better pool listening to this song, trust me.
Anybody could play Locomotion. Sounds good, Ben. Let's get started. Grand Funk Railroad from their prime period.
Yeah. I'm destined to lose it. I'm losing my way. There won't be no more choosing come the judgment day. There's no place for me to go, but I know darn well when it comes time for me to leave, I'm going straight, straight.
Well, Ben Upham, we're getting off to a rousing start with our tribute to Grand Funk Railroad tonight.
I'm liking it.
Very good. One thing I did want to mention, Ben, something of a curiosity perhaps you can help me out with, is that for some reason, Grand Funk was one of those American bands whose success did not translate real well across the Atlantic to the British Isles. They had a total of 9 U.S. LPs in the top 10 in their meteoric career, but only one single in the British charts. No albums hit the British charts. And earlier, before we started this program tonight, Ben dared me to take a guess as to what single it was that was a hit. So I said, okay, go ahead. And he said, well, was it Inside Looking Out? And bingo, Ben, you did your homework. How did you come up with that anyway? What's the inside secret?
I just finished reading the Grand Funk autobiography of Mark Farner.
Oh, okay, so it's not that dramatic. I was hoping you'd say something like osmosis, or it was in the airwaves, or the brain waves just happened to metamorphosize, and that's what came out at that particular moment. But that'll do. I mean, that's practical. But any reason you can think of why the Brits just did not adapt to Grand Funk?
I think they just hadn't played there yet. They had such phenomenal success here early on. The second show that Grand Funk Railroad ever played was in front of 180,000 people, and they were the opening band. It was at the Atlanta Pop Festival in 1969. They played alongside Creedence Clearwater, Led Zeppelin, Janis Joplin, and they did really well. They got 2 encores, but that was the second show they'd ever played, and that opened the door to, you know, a lot of popularity.
So Terry Knight, their manager, must have been opening a lot of doors to get him a slot on a festival like that, because that is primetime exposure.
He did. And they were invited back next year, but they did that summer in 69, they did a whole tour of festivals. They were actually invited to play Woodstock, but they had prior commitments. They did the Texas Pop Festival, and there was like 3 or 4 other major ones, and so they got huge exposure.
And they were known for delivering the goods on stage.
Absolutely. Very high energy, and that's what we're going to do here in our next set. I'm going to take us to Hawaii, Halloween 1970, for a very, very rare and extremely hot version of a song called In Need, which was off of their second album. However, this is a rare bootleg version that I obtained back when I was, I think, a junior in high school.
Okay, and you said that this song has a story for you. This was something you'd use to convert the skeptics?
I had a lot of friends in high school that didn't think Grand Funk was very cool, and they'd pretty much say, why are you wasting your time listening to that? And I'd say, look, give me 10 minutes and then tell me what you think. Okay, give me 12 minutes.
12 minutes.
And I would play them this version of In Need, and usually by the time the song was over, they'd have a big grin and go, pat me on the back going, you're right, you're right. Let's see what that does here to Spokane. Let's play it tonight over the airwaves and see if we can't get a few other listeners over on our side.
Well, I think that's the only way for a true test. We just have to hear it for ourselves and make up our own minds, right?
Well, all I can say is turn the volume up. It needs it.
Okay, up to 12 maybe.
Why right? Not?
real good friend.
Fun.
You sure got a real good friend.
Fun.
A friend.
With a bit more Mark Farner lead guitar in the background, Ben Upham, we truly did hear some real axe-mangling string bending by Farner on our last selection, did we not?
Indeed we did. An interesting story, when I met Mark in 1992, I commented on that solo to him, and I told him it reminded me of him tying knots with the notes. And he looked me right in the eye and he says, "That's weird, because I always saw it like I was untying the knots."
Untying versus tying. Okay, you were on the same page, at least in the same chapter, definitely.
It was pretty interesting.
Yeah. Funny how musicians sometimes think of finishing out their solos, how they see music, and it varies from person to person.
Well, that was one of my favorite bootlegs that I ever owned, and like I say, it did convince a few people to at least give Grand Funk a little more of a listen.
Ah, yes, those were the days. Vinyl bootlegs.
And, of course, I put them onto 8-tracks.
You did?
Oh, yeah. That's what we'd take them up on the hill, play them in our cars, you know.
Yeah, okay. Check it out. Check out the new sounds that weren't available elsewhere. Speaking of sounds being available, Grand Funk was never really a big radio band, were they? In the early days, at least?
Not in the early days, but of course, once Todd Rundgren took the helm as producer, you had American Band and then Locomotion, which was 2 number one hits. You know, and that was, they're playing those songs on AM radio even. I mean, it got pretty big at that point.
Well, we talked about that a bit earlier off mic. Let's go over that. How did Todd Rundgren end up producing them when they had Terry Knight? There was a very bitter split, wasn't there?
Yeah, Terry Knight sued the band and basically got everything they owned. Got their money, got their equipment, got their royalties.
They probably would have had their women if he wanted them too.
Yeah, I don't know, but
the courts might have ruled that way at least.
Yeah, the one thing the band did retain was the name, which gave him the chance to tour again and record under that name, which was already popular, so it saved them. But at that point they were kind of at a do or die situation where they had to start making some hits, and they did.
So I guess the message on that is, kids, if you're in the music business, find out the name of a good music business lawyer.
Yeah. Well, don't get screwed the way they did. It was a tough road and a lot of scars that are still healing. But it was sweet, you know, that they came back and had such a good career afterwards.
Yes, they did soldier on, and Todd Rundgren got involved as a producer. And matter of fact, they also had an album later on produced by no less than Frank Zappa.
1976. It was called Good Singing, Good Playing. Wonderful, wonderful CD, and you can go out to your stores and buy it. It's even got a bonus track called Rubberneck.
So there is a good reason indeed why Grand Funk called one of their albums Survivor.
Survival.
Survival, okay.
Yes, but that was actually the last Terry Knight album.
It was. There's some irony there.
Maybe they knew what was going to happen.
Yeah. What is it we have coming up next?
We're going to go back to the very first song that Grand Funk ever recorded. This was recorded in April of 1969. It's the first song that Mark Farner ever wrote. It's called Heartbreaker, and it was their second single. After that song, I've been thinking recently about the atrocities that have been happening in Russia with the children recently, the hostage situation and the horrible ending, and in trying to decide what songs to play for the show tonight, I happen to think of a tribute to children and children's innocence, and it's a beautiful song that they had on their Phoenix album in 1972 called Freedom Is for Children.
A whole different side of Grand Funk Railroad.
Yeah, well, they got a lot of sides, so I don't have a whole lot of time tonight. I'm trying to present a bit of the other side.
Good. Good balanced portrait. Thank you, Ben.
Sometimes I think about her, but you know she's not really there. When memories do call, I just can't live without her. All the time, it's so hard to
Now, Ben, earlier we mentioned the long string of best-selling albums Grand Funk had, a couple of number one hit singles a little bit later on in the mid-70s in Locomotion, and what was the other one again?
Quick. American Band.
Thank you for saving me on that one. I guess my point on this was that best-selling albums, but not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame at this point.
No, and that's kind of, it's a crime. I don't understand what the process is that would get them there, but they're not.
They're not.
No.
Yeah. A bit more of the history on Grand Funk. They reformed briefly in 1981, sort of. Didn't really go out on tour with all three original members. There was a group called Flint, which, Ben, what's your reaction to Flint?
Flint was Grand Funk without Mark Farner, and they released one record, I believe, in 1978 or 79, and it wasn't bad, but it didn't do anything for me.
And Mark Farner went on to a solo career a little bit later in the 70s?
Right. He'd released two solo albums at the tail end of the 70s, and then he did a Christian rock career in the 80s and early 90s, and now he's back to performing with a trio called Energy, and they play all old Grand Funk material.
Now, Farner wrote most of that Grand Funk material, did he not, at least in the early days?
First three albums, he wrote every song. And then after that, he started splitting the duties.
Okay. How about the vocals?
He split those, too. Coming, actually, around their fourth or their fifth album, Don Brewer started to sing a few of the songs. And, of course, he sings on American Band, which at the time was the biggest hit they'd ever had.
Okay. Is it a coincidence that when Mark Farner stopped writing most of the songs, their album sales started to decline, maybe?
I think actually that you have that backwards.
Okay.
They actually picked up.
They did.
In 73 with American Band, that was, I think, their highest charting record at that point.
As far as sales?
Yes.
Okay, but that was a little bit poppier, I guess. I'm thinking of the, was Mark more on the hard rocking end of it?
You mean on American Band?
Yeah.
That album was more polished. That's the first album they'd brought in Todd Rundgren, and they needed a hit because they'd lost everything to Terry Knight.
As we talked about earlier.
Right.
Yeah. Well, which brings us in kind of a roundabout way to a little bit later on in their career. We've got something really special for the listeners lined up next, don't we?
Well, yes, we do, John. I ran into an old jogging buddy of mine here a couple years back, Arnold Stirrup, and he happened to have a tape of the Mark Farner Band when they played out at the Good Times pub out in the valley back on July 26, 1992. And so anyway, if any of you listeners out there might have been at that show, you might stir your memory a bit here.
Might stir your memory from Arnold. Thank you very much. This is Mark Farner Band and a version of what, Closer to Home?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
And Ben Upham, any last thoughts on Grand Funk?
Just thank you for letting me play this tonight, John. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome, Ben. Thank you for guesting. And we did have to get at least that last refrain in, getting closer. Sounding pretty indeed. Next week, Johnson's Improbable History of Pop, T-Bone Burnett, cross-section of this very Texas singer-songwriter's career. This is John Johnson, KPBX-FM. Many thanks for listening. You are in tune with KPBX-FM Spokane and KIBX-FM Bonner's Ferry.